Next one is ideal force with the friction. Okay, so here ideal force with the friction means here we have a die, container and die. We apply pressure or force in this direction. So this is the die angle alpha. Okay, actually material has to divide the flow according to the angle alpha. And there will be a friction between the workpiece and the container, that is mu. So here we should consider mu because we consider the ideal force with the friction. Ideal force with the friction. And here in this, this is the equation. I am not going to derive this equation. This is the equations to calculate P. So what are the different parameters or different factors which are affecting this friction, pressure? When the friction is a factor, here we can see alpha, mu. Mu is a factor. Mu directly proportional to mu. P and mu are directly proportional. The second factor is alpha. Alpha. So I will explain the influence of alpha later, because the increase of alpha in sometime it is increase the p value or sometime it is decrease the p value. So I will explain the alpha influence in p later. Second one is sigma y. Sigma y, if it is a, again, it is a perfectly plastic material, we should use sigma y. If it is a strain hardened material, we should use sigma f, flow stress of the material. Okay. Then another one more factor is r value. R value is nothing but it is a ratio of the cross section area of the workpiece and the cross section area of the final extruder product. That is also P also proportional to R value. Okay. So P proportional to R value, P proportional to mu, and there is an influence of alpha value on the P. Okay. Then next year, if it is assumed that friction stress is equal to the yield strength of the material, shear yield strength of the material, and we consider 45 degree alpha angle, alpha is equal to 45 degree, then the friction stress, that is corresponding to friction, we can say sigma friction, we can say friction stress. Sigma friction is equal to K value, that is the amount of shear stress required for the shearing. For example, during the sliding motion between the container wall and the workpiece surface, there is a chance for the shearing of the surface of the workpiece. Shearing, that means one layer of the workpiece, so this is my workpiece, one layer of the workpiece may shear with respect to the bottom portion. The surface region there is a chance for the shearing. So what is the critical shear stress required for this type of shearing? That is this K value. So if this friction stress, that actually the friction is developed between the workpiece and the container wall, if the frictional stress is equal to the shear stress of the critical shear stress of the material, that is K, then that is called sticking condition. We already discussed that sticking condition in the forging module. And we consider the sticking condition here, and we consider the alpha value equal to 45 degree. Then we can rewrite this equation like this. We can rewrite the equation like this. Here, the important factor is this RE value, that is ratio of initial cross-section and final cross-section, sigma F or sigma Y. Length of contact. The length of contact is nothing but it is the contact between the workpiece and die during the deformation. That is the contact length L. And D0 is the initial diameter of the workpiece. Okay. So these are the different factors which affect the pressure. And here we can see as the ram travel further forward, L decreases. Okay. During this, when the ram move forward, and this also a factor, L value. This is also L value. So when ram move forward, the L value will decrease. L value will decrease. So correspondingly, the pressure also will decrease. So this is the second case. That is ideal force with the friction. Third case is actual force. So we here in the previous case we consider only friction. We consider the ratio extrusion ratio R value. Then we consider the die angle alpha value. But there are different other factors also. Okay, there is an important factor which is related to the inhomogeneous deformation. We studied the inhomogeneous deformation in case of metal flow. Here in this metal flow, these two are inhomogeneous deformation. So for this inhomogeneous deformation, we need to supply additional energy. Okay, this is the ideal case. This one is the ideal case. In case of ideal case, we the supplied energy can be completely utilized for plastic deformation. But these two actual case, so there will be some inhomogeneous deformation in the actual case. So we need to apply additional force or additional pressure for inhomogeneous deformation. Okay, so this is very difficult to calculate the amount of force or pressure in case of inhomogeneous deformation. So what we can do, we develop in a empirical formula. We study different factors, influence of different factors by conducting different experiments, and from the experiments we develop a formula, and in this formula we incorporate the effect of inhomogeneous deformation. But in the previous two ideal case, we are not considering the influence of inhomogeneous deformation here, but we consider the inhomogeneous deformation influence by these two factors A and B. Okay, then by doing different experiments, we concluded that the value of A equal to approximately equal to 0.8 value, and the value of B is approximately equal to between 1.2 to 1.5 value. Okay, so by substituting this 0.8 and the range 1.2 to 1.5 depend upon the condition, and Re value and the sigma y value of the material, we got the pressure value. How much amount of pressure is required for the deformation in actual case? Of course, the pressure required in the actual case will be greater than that of the ideal for ideal conditions. These two ideal conditions. Okay, this will be the it will be the higher value. So this is the amount of pressure required in the actual case. Okay. So next one is optimum die angle. So we have. We can make the die with a different angle. It can be 90 degree, 45 degree, 60 degree, 120 degree. Different die angle is possible. Which one is the best suitable die angle which minimizes the pressure and force requirement for the deformation of the material? So there are different factors which influence the die angle. Okay. First one is in ideal case. If it is an ideal case without friction, then the die angle is not an influencing factor. We can see when we derive the equation for ideal force without friction, there is no alpha value here. There is no alpha value here. So that means there is no influence of die angle. In case of ideal case, this R value and the sigma y value are the two influencing factors. So in case of the ideal case, there is no influence of die angle on the extrusion force or extrusion pressure. So it will be a constant. Okay, extrusion pressure and the force will be a constant with a wide variety of die angle. But if there is a friction, then with the increase of die angle, with the decrease of die angle, with the decrease of this is the directional decrease in die angle, the friction force is increasing. That means if you use 120 degree die angle, the friction force may be this much. But if you decrease the die angle to 45 degree, this will be the die angle. So with respect to decrease of die angle, what happened? The friction force will be increased. The amount of friction between the die or container and the workpiece will increase. Okay. So that what is the reason for that? If we decrease the die angle, we can see when we decrease the die angle, for example, this is a one die angle with a lower die angle, and this is another die angle, for example, 120 die angle. Okay, and this is the corresponding, one, and this is the 120 die angle. Okay, here we can see the contact length. Here in the 120 die angle, This is the contact length. For 45 diagonal, this much is the contact length. So if we reduce the diagonal, the contact length is increased. Contact length is increased means there are more contact area of the sliding. That means the friction force will increase. Okay, so that is the reason that with respect to decrease in diagonal, the contact length will increase. Of course, the friction also will increase. Okay, that is the reason. So that is the influence of friction force and diagonal on the extrusion force. There is another one more factor. One more factor is there. With respect to increase in diagonal, there will be redundant deformation increase. Redundant deformation increase with the increase in diagonal. What is the redundant deformation? Actually, in an ideal case of deformation, the material flow is like this. This is a very smooth material flow. But here, in this case, there will be a redundant deformation. That means the redundant deformation means the deformation such that there will be a shear. There will be a. In this area, there will be a shear between different layers of the material. Okay, because this is a not a perfect or ideal fluid flow or material flow. So here in this area, there will be a shear between the material. Okay, here we can see a shear between the material. Okay, to overcome the shear between the material, since there is a dead zone creation, so huge amount of additional force or work has to supply to overcome this additional shear between the material. But here we cannot see such type of shear in the ideal case. But in this B and C case, because of this inhomogeneous deformation, there will be a requirement of additional energy to overcome the shear between the material. Okay, that is called redundant energy or redundant deformation. So when the diagonal increase, the chance for this redundant deformation will increase. We can see, for example, if it is a 90 degree diagonal, the material has to flow in this direction, then it has to flow that actually the direction variation is very huge. But we can see the 45 degree angle. This is a 45 degree angle. The material can easily flow very smoothly here. Can very smoothly flow here. So, amount of redundant deformation is higher in case of 90 degree when compared with the 45 degree. So, with respect to increase in diagonal, we can see a huge increase in the energy or force or pressure requirement for this redundant deformation. So, we can conclude that with respect to increasing the alpha value, the redundant deformation is increasing, but with the increase in the alpha value, the friction is decreasing. Both the redundant deformation and the friction influence the friction force. So we can calculate the total force by comparing all the diagrams. So this is the diagram of total force. From this, we got at a particular point, at this point, the total force requirement is very low and the corresponding diagonal is called optimum diagonal. This is the optimum diagonal for a particular extrusion process with a minimum total force. Okay, so and in that case, there is a trade-off between frictional force and a redundant force. Both will be minimum. Friction force and the redundant force will be minimum, total force will be minimum. So this alpha value corresponding to this total minimum total force, this is called optimum diagonal. So during an extrusion process of a particular material, choose a diagonal which has alpha optimum value. Okay, that is the optimum diagonal. So next, finally, we have a hot extrusion process. So far, we discussed the cold extrusion process. In hot extrusion process, in the last lectures, I already discussed when the temperature is very high, temperature is very high, the influence of the strain rate on the sigma y value or sigma f value is very huge. Okay, so in hot extrusion process, we know the temperature is very high because the workpiece is under very high temperature. So any variation in the strain rate, what you know, what is strain rate? Slower pressing, strain rate is very small. Impact force or hammering or sudden ram movement, strain rate is very high. So in hot extrusion process, the strain rate is an important factor. Okay, so here in this hot extrusion process, the strain rate is an important factor. So we use the strain rate term also in the equation to calculate P and F. Okay, to calculate P and F. So that is the only difference between the cold extrusion and the hot extrusion process. So here, this is the equation to calculate the strain rate. Just I added here. This strain rate, if we consider the die angle alpha is equal to 45 degree and poor lubrication, that means very high friction between the die and workpiece, the strain rate equation can be reduced like this. Okay, there is an influence of strain rate. Just that keep in mind. Then this is the equation. Actual case, this is the equation to calculate the extrusion pressure or extrusion force. And this is an empirical formula. Here Ke value is a constant value that is depend upon the material and depend upon the temperature, etc. Okay, so for a particular material, for example, if you take copper. Copper at 600 degrees Celsius, we can calculate the K value, that is 200. So from the data book, we got this Ke value by conducting different experiment. We can plot this graph. So this is also already available in the data book. From that, we can calculate the Ke value. From this, we can calculate the pressure and force. Okay. So that is the hot extrusion process. But theoretically, we should consider the extrusion rate, strain rate in the equation. Strain rate is a very influencing factor in case of hot extrusion compared to cold extrusion process. Okay. So there are different types of varieties of extrusion process. This is a cold extrusion process. This is actually a combination with the forging process. We create it for making different automobile components. So here what we do, this is an extrusion process. Here, this is the die. This is the die. Die area, this one. Okay. So this is RAM. We move forward. Then we can make this type of component. Component with the this cross section. And this is what we already discussed, the back extrusion process. And here, this is a one cavity also. Okay. So the final product will be like this. Final product will be like this. Okay. This will be the shape of the final product. To make this type of product, which is somewhat similar to the toothpaste tube or any tube material. So, cold extrusion process, this is actually carried out at a room temperature, that is why it is called a cold extrusion process. Second one, there are different advantages. Thus, by means of strain hardening, the output product will have very high strength. Then good surface finish, production rate is high, good dimension tolerance. But we should make a die with a high strength, toughness, resistance to wear material. Okay, the die should be very strong. Or RAM. Either die or RAM. Okay. Then impact extrusion. I already discussed that we can make these hollow tubes using back extrusion process. This impact extrusion is one type of back extrusion process. And here in this is the material, workpiece. This is the workpiece. And this is the die. Okay. Then we apply the compressive force through the die or through the punch or RAM. So what happened? We can see a clearance between the die and the punch. When we apply very huge amount of force, the material extrude like this around the periphery of this punch, extruded like this. So we got a tube, a very small thickness tubes. Okay, the toothpaste tube we can make using this food can, beverage container, Coca-Cola or other beverage containers we can make using this. And collapsible medical tube, medicine tubes, etc. We can make use in this. Okay. So actually the clearance between the punch and die determine the wall thickness. It's a very low cost process. We can make very high productivity, very high surface finish. Okay, so we can use plastic products or plastic material, or we can use metal products also. We can make metal products also using this IMBAT extrusion process. Commonly use this process in industries for making this type of products. Hydrostatic extrusion. The main problem in extrusion process is the friction between the workpiece and the container. How can we eliminate this friction? Kept water or the hydrostatic fluid in between the workpiece and the container. So there will not be any contact between the workpiece and the container. Okay. So when we apply a compressive force, what happens? The fluid is compressed and this fluid exerts a force on the workpiece and workpiece starts to deform. So we can eliminate the friction between the workpiece and the container by using hydrostatic extrusion. So here we apply around 1400 megapascal pressure onto this fluid. Okay, we can use vegetable oil, we can use as a fluid, or castor oil we can use as a fluid. Okay, so based on the type of workpiece and extrusion material, we can choose the fluid. Different types of oils we can choose as a fluid. We apply very huge amount of pressure into the oil or fluid. So that is a hydrostatic extrusion process. If you use a cold extrusion, we can use this castor oil vegetable material. But if it is a hot extrusion process, in case of hot extrusion process, we cannot use this type of fluids. Okay. So in that case, we use solid lubricants, solid lubricant materials kept in between the billet and rod, like graphite materials. Solid lubricant materials are available. We use this solid lubricant material for this hydrostatic extrusion. But in case of if it is a cold extrusion process, workpiece in the cold state, we can use castor oil or vegetable oil, etc. for hydrostatic extrusion. Okay. Then coaxial extrusion. For example, I want to make a product like this. This is my copper material. Okay. A copper material. Around the common material, I want to cover it with cladding it with aluminum material. Okay, aluminum material cladding. So what we do in this case, we can use coaxial extrusion. So how we do coaxial extrusion? So this is my extrusion die. In this, first we kept the copper material. This is my copper material. Okay. Then I insert the aluminum material here. Okay. Aluminum material here. So this is my aluminum material. Okay. So now after extrusion, so the copper during the extrusion process, when we apply the ram force here, what happened? The copper extruded like this and the aluminum extruded on the periphery of the copper. So we got this type of material. So this is called cladding. So for example, copper is coated with the silver, cladded with the silver. Okay. Or steel is cladded with the copper. So this type of products can be made using coaxial extrusion process. So this is another variety of process. Any clarification in this four process? Cold extrusion, impact extrusion, hydrostatic, coaxial extrusion. Defects in extrusion process. Basically, there are three extrusion defects. That is, first one, surface cracking. Second one is pipe effect. Third one is internal cracking. So, surface cracks are produced on the final product. And basically, the surface crack, one type of surface crack is called bamboo defect. Okay, this is mainly we can see in aluminium, magnesium, zinc based material. What happened here? This is because of the very high friction, temperature and speed, very high speed. So when we do an extrusion process for a material with a high friction, high temperature and doing this extrusion at a very high rate, then there is a chance for the cracking of the surface. So we can see some cracks on the surface, or tearing, or a certain type of crack on the surface. And how can we avoid? Use the billet with the low temperature and low extrusion speed, then we can avoid this surface cracking. And one type of surface crack is bamboo defect. Bamboo defect. What is bamboo defect? For example, we extrude a material through a die. So when we do extrusion, there is a chance for the, this is my workpiece material, there is a chance for the sticking of the workpiece with the container wall. Okay, the workpiece material under the container wall, there will be a adhesive force or a sticking, okay, during the extrusion process. So what we do when there is a sticking, we need to apply higher force. So we apply higher force during the extrusion to overcome the sticking force. So the sticking force is actually a bond. That bond is damage out. So again, the workpiece material moving forward. Okay. Again, we can see a sticking. Again, when it move forward, we reduce the force. Again, leads to a sticking. Again, there will be a sticking between the workpiece and the die wall or container wall. Again, we apply high force. Okay. So this process is continued, and the final product will have a bamboo-like structure. There will be a surface crack in the, or a some type of cracks or defects we can see in the intermediate level. Okay, in the intermediate level, this is called bamboo defect. This is because of the sticking. That when the extruder product sticks on the die, the extrusion pressure increases. So when the extrusion pressure increases, what happens? The product again starts to move. So during the movement, there is no such type of defect. But there is a sticking, this type of defect will be produced. So this is a continuous process. The output product will be a structure like a bamboo structure. So the surface will be like a bamboo surface, and this is called bamboo defect. So this is the first defects we can see on the extruder product. Second defect is pipe defect. We already discussed that this is the actual metal flow with very high friction. We can see the dead zone is extended towards this region. Dead zone. Okay. So here in this, what happened? This type of metal flow leads to this type of defects, that is pipe defect. What happened? In the raw material will have some impurities on the surface. There will be some oxides or some impurities on the surface. So when the metal flow through the die, this impurities actually are accumulated at the center region of the final product. Okay, this is because of this type of metal flow. The impurities which is accumulated in the center region, and the final product, when we take the final product, in the center region we can see this type of impurities like oxides, other impurities we can see at the center region of the final product. So this is called pipe defect. And this pipe defect, the main two reasons for this pipe defect is this type of metal flow. Okay, inhomogeneous metal flow. The second region is the impurities on the surface of the workpiece. Okay, so this is the second defect, that is called pipe defect. Third defect is internal cracking. Internal cracking is produced because of the hydrostatic tensile stresses developed at the center region of the extruder product. So when we deform through this in between the die, what happened? The center region will be subjected to tensile stress. Hydrostatic tensile stress. This hydrostatic tensile stress will develop a crack at the center region, and that is the reason for internal cracks at the center. So this hydrostatic extrusion that is already I explained, this hydrostatic extrusion is the main reason for this internal cracking. Okay, so we can see this final product, we can see as internal cracks here in the final product. So this is the third defect, internal cracking. Okay, so there are different factors which affect friction, die angle, extrusion ratio, also affect this type of defect, central internal cracking. So these are the three defects, internal cracking, pipe defect, surface cracking.